Hello children, once again you all are welcome and we are going to start with a new topic today, that is soils of India. And before we start with it, again I will tell you the same thing here. If you like this video which is being discussed here, right, anyhow, if the video is going to help you out in understanding the topic for your exam or for your competitions and all, please don't forget to subscribe the channel. Okay, so let's start with the topic, soils of India. Right, now first of all, what is meant by soil? What is the importance of soil? Soil is basically what? Soil is a thin layer of the earth's crust. Yes, you can say soil is a thin layer of the earth's crust, which is mainly responsible for the plants and trees and all the greeneries to grow over there. These are basically formed, the soils are formed by the weathering and disintegration of the rocks. But yes, the soil is one of the factors which are present on earth, right, which further helps in survival of life on earth. Now soil, basically you should understand children how the soils are formed. You know, in a country like India is a very vast country, right? And here, because of such a vast area we are covering within our country, you'll find different type of soils are found within our country, right? Okay, now basically what are the factors behind it? What factors are responsible for it, this variation in the different type of soils? Basic, the most important factors which are responsible here in the variation, right, from one place to the other, the soil differs. For that, main factors responsible are the parent rock. Okay, any area, if we go, the soil to a great extent, it depends on the rock which is present there, right? Rock means bedrock. Okay, underlying rock which is present there, that is called parent rock. So many times, you know children, soil is actually formed by the disintegration of the parent rock, right? Many times you will find the soil is actually found at that same place where it has got its origin, where it has got originated, right? But in some other cases you'll find the soil has got originated at one place and then it is carried somewhere else and it is actually deposited at some other place. So there that soil is called as transported soil, right? And at the place where the soil is found and it has got originated at the same place, there this soil is called as residual soil, right? To a great extent, children, now you can say that the parent rock is responsible for the formation of soil. If the parent rock is igneous, the soil which is formed out of it by the disintegration of rock or the weathering of rock will be black soil. Its color will be quite similar to its parent rock. Have you understood the relation between the two? Yes. Same way, the features of parent rock and the soil which is there above that, which has been formed by that rock, right? Features of both will be quite similar, right? So this is how parent rock is one important factor in the formation of soil. Number two is relief. Okay, relief is actually the landforms, you can say, right? Now several places you'll find if any plain area is there, over plain, the depth of soil, you can say the thickness of soil, right, or the soil profile, that will be more. But if you think of any the mountainous slope or the hill slope, there the thickness of soil will be less. What is the reason? Because there the soil will not remain for long, na? It is being washed away by water, right? So their thickness will be very less. Moreover, humus content also in that case will be very less. Humus content, the organic matter which makes the soil fertile. So in this way, relief also is an important factor for the soil formation. And what type of soil will be found, for that it also works as an important factor. Next is flora, fauna, microorganism. That means, again, just now what I said, humus content. The upper layer, upper thin layer of the soil, right, which is actually formed by several organic matter. Okay, the decomposed material from any of the dead remains of animals and plants and all, that forms humus. And that is actually the most important thing which makes any soil infertile or makes any soil fertile. If humus content is more, definitely the soil is more fertile. If humus content is less, soil will be less fertile. Understood? Now here what we are talking of is what amount of living organisms, or you can say the remains of living organisms, are present in the soil. That is again, you can say, going to affect the humus content of the soil and definitely the soil formation, the type of soil in that area. Next is the time, right? Now time, yes, time also is an important factor, because you know, children, a very thin layer of soil in its formation, it takes thousands of years. So that's why time again plays an important role. Wherever very thick layer of soil is present, that means there time has been an important factor to actually allow that deposition to go on, right? But in some other places, children, suppose time is not much, right? The soil has been formed recently, right? Soil has been deposited recently. So what will happen? It is understood that the soil will be very thin. The layer of soil will be very thin. Or the other way you can say, the soil profile will be very thin in that case. Clear? So in this way, time also affects the soil formation. Then come to climate. Climate again is very, very important factor. What comes under climate? I told you, temperature and rainfall, right? Now, wherever the weathering of rock take place, the temperature and rainfall play very important role there, right? So temperature as well as rainfall, water, both are main agents which cause weathering on large scale, right? Now what is weathering? Breaking down of rock into small particles that forms the soil. Understood? So presence of temperature and rainfall, to what level it is present, and it is definitely going to affect the weathering of rock, right? Or you can say the soil formation, as well as the humus content of the soil, right? So in this way, children, you can, I think, now able to be, understand this very clearly, that these are the main factors that affect the formation of soil. Now, children, we have to discuss here about the soil profile, right? Now, what is actually the meaning of soil profile? In the earlier part, we were discussing about it. What does this term mean? It is actually nothing but it shows that the actual formation of soil, okay, from the underlying bedrock or the parent rock, how the soil is formed, one layer, then second layer, then third layer. Every layer gives us a clear picture how the actual soil which is found on the surface of earth is formed from the underlying bedrock. Okay. Or the other way we can say that it is a vertical cross section of the different layers of formation of soil. Deep inside you will find the first layer is actually the bedrock, or it is also called parent rock. So the lowest layer of it is called as the bedrock. Okay. From this bedrock only, or you can say it is also called many times as a parent rock. Parent rock. That means from the parent rock only, the soil which is formed has actually got weathered, and now it is the result of that parent rock, weathering of that parent rock. So in this way, you can easily relate, you know, when the parent rock is igneous rock, The soil formed will be ultimately a dark colored soil and it will be black soil, right? If the parent rock is somewhat crystalline metamorphic rocks, the resultant soil which will be formed over it will be suppose the red soil. Okay, so all these are interrelated. Clear? Now, first layer, you can say the first layer, the lowest layer of it is the parent rock or bedrock, it is called. Okay, a little when the weathering of this rock take place, it results into the formation of a little, you can say the next layer, right? A little above the parent rock or the bedrock, it is found, and this is called as substratum. It is called the substratum, and substratum is actually, you can say, the first layer of the formation of soil, right? This is the beginning of the soil formation. Okay, now come to the next one. Next layer of it is called the subsoil, right? Subsoil is again a, you can say, next stage of this formation of soil, right, which is called subsoil. Now, subsoil always has got less humus content. The particles are still coarser, right? Coarser means the particles are still bigger in size. Again, it goes on. Actually, it is the process of weathering go on. And then ultimately, you'll find this subsoil changes into the topsoil. Okay, the uppermost layer of the soil is called the topsoil. Clear? Now, as compared to subsoil, you will find that the topsoil is made up of very fine particles, right? Subsoil, the particles are quite, you can say the particles are bigger than what we find in the case of topsoil. So, ultimately, again, if the subsoil is weathered, right, that results into the formation of topsoil with very fine particles. Moreover, the topsoil always, you will find, children, has got the humus content, right? Humus is there. Now, what is humus? Humus is nothing but it is decomposed organic matter which is present in the soil, the uppermost layer of the soil. Okay, it is the humus content only which makes the soil fertile, and this is actually present in the topmost layer of the soil. A very thin layer is formed over the soil that is actually called humus. Clear now? So the entire formation of soil, right, from bedrock to substratum, then subsoil, then topsoil, so different layers of it can easily be studied with the help of this vertical cross section. And this vertical cross section of different layers of soil formation is called as soil profile. Then come to next one, children. On the basis of, you know, on the basis of the formation, right, of soil, where it is found, you can say, the soil which is found at one place where it has been formed by the bedrocks, that soil can be called as residual soil, or many times it is also called by the name in situ soil. Right? But as compared to that, suppose if the soil is formed at one place, right, it has been formed by the weathering of any rocks, and then it is transported from that place, from the place of its origin, to some other place, right? So when this happens, suppose any agent of gradation, right, any agent of denudation is involved in transporting the soil from one place to the other, right? So when it transports the soil from one place to the other and the soil is deposited again at some other place, so there that soil will be called as transported soil. Transported soil. Okay. Which is the result of transportation. Clear? And this type of soil is also called by the name ex situ soil. Okay. Ex situ. Now, can you get an idea in India, if we name the alluvial soil, of which category the alluvial soil, you can say, from which of these two categories the alluvial soil belong? Yes. What is alluvial soil? It is deposited by the sediments brought down by various agents of gradation. That is called alluvial soil. So it is always a transported soil. Okay? Always alluvial soil is taken as a transported soil, because the reason is what? From one place the weathered particles are taken by any agent, right? And all these are deposited at some other place. So naturally it is the result of transportation. Transportation of sediments or transportation of the weathered particles. Clear? And that's why this type of soil is called as transported soil. Alluvial soil is called as transported soil. But when we come to the other side, residual soil, or we also call it in-situ soil, right? Now what happens in this case? Residual soil remains at the same place where it has got originated, where it has been formed. It is not carried anywhere. Okay, children. So what is residual soil now? You can give the best example of it. Suppose black soil, okay, red soil, laterite soil. These all soils are formed at the same place where we can find all these soils. Okay, one more point of difference you can say here. Suppose transported soil. If we say that transported soils have got certain features which are quite similar as that of the underlying bedrocks, is it correct or not? Just think of it once. Again, I'm repeating. If I say the transported soil, right? Transported soils have got actually the features same as that of the underlying bedrocks. Is it correct? No. Why it is not correct? Because you know, children, it is actually taken from one place and it is deposited in some other place, right? So how it can have the same features as that of any bedrock over which this soil is present, right? Because this soil has been taken from somewhere, some other place. So when this soil is taken from somewhere else, how it can have the same features of that, the underlying bedrocks in that area? It will not have, right? But on the other side, if you take residual soil, because residual soil is formed just above that particular place only, right? If any underlying bedrock is there, it keeps on getting weathered again and again and again. And ultimately, the time comes when it is actually converted into very fine particles, and this then forms the layer of soil. So residual soil is the soil which always has got the features same as that of the underlying bedrocks. Okay, you can see the examples for transported soil. The example, best example in India is alluvial soil, right? Same way, if you are talking about the residual soil, you'll find three major the soils are there. Number one is black soil, the next is red soil, and the laterite soil. All these belong to this category, that is residual soil, or we also call it in situ soil. Is this much clear to all of you children? Yes. Now within India, you'll find there are basically four type of soils all over in our country we can find. Right? Now, let's talk about all these different soil types one by one. Right? The first type of soil which is found in India is alluvial soil. Okay? Alluvial soil. It is formed by the deposition work done by various agents of gradation. Right? Now, in India, there are different type of soils we find all over India, right? Due to the variations in climatic condition, due to variation in the amount of rainfall, vegetation, different things are there, right? But major soils, what we have to study here are only four, right? Number one is red soil, number two is black soil, number three alluvial, and number four is laterite soil. Out of all these four types of soils, alluvial soil belongs to which category? Transported soil. Okay, or it is also called as ex situ soil. But what about red soil, black soil and laterite soils? These soils belong to residual, or these are also called as in situ soil. Clear now? Now let's start with the first type of soil, which is found in India on large area. You'll find is covered by alluvial soils, right? Especially the northern plains of India. Maximum part of the northern plains are covered with the alluvial soils, right? And this alluvial soil is also of two types. Okay, one is called new alluvium, the other is called old alluvium. Okay, and new alluvium is also called by another name, that is called khadar, and old alluvium is known by the name bhangad. Okay, now what is the basic difference between the two? Now here we have to discuss about the first type of soils which are found in India. Okay, and that is alluvial soil. And this alluvial soil is the best example of transported soil, at least in the Indian subcontinent. Okay, now this is actually most extensively found in India. And what are the main characteristics of this soil? It is actually brownish colored soil. Brownish, or you can say light grayish color is the color of this. Okay, moreover, the particles, right, the texture of the soil is sandy, right? It can be, you know, from the western side, from the western part of the northern plains, if we move towards the eastern side, we find the texture gets very fine. Okay, towards the western side, if you see, that is having a sandy type of texture. But as we move towards the east, when we reach in the central part of India, central plains of India, you will find the texture of this alluvial soil is a bit like, you can say, loamy, right? And as we move towards the eastern side further, towards the West Bengal side, you will find that the texture has become very fine, that is clay type soil. Okay? According to the texture, children, we can classify the soils into three categories. Number one is sandy, a little coarser particles. Okay, then loamy. Loamy is actually having neither so coarser or nor so fine particles. It is intermediate level. Okay, and the third one is clay soil. Clay soil has got always very fine particles. Okay, so in this way we categorize, and all the three types you can find from the western side. As we move towards the east, the particles of soil or the texture of soil starts changing, and it changes from sandy towards east. As we go, it changes to the clay. Okay, next feature of it is the alluvial soil is rich in potash, lime, right? And moreover, you know, it is deficient generally in maximum part of the plain areas or the regions where alluvial soil is found. You'll see that the nitrogen and humus contents are deficient in the alluvial soil. Then in certain parts only, you'll find, suppose in deltaic regions, a little nitrogen content as well as humus content is found a little more. Right, as compared to that, if you see the rest of the alluvial regions, you will find the alluvial soil has got it is rich in potash and lime, but it has got the nitrogen and humus content deficient in it. Okay, now come to the next one. It varies in texture. You can see varies in texture. Just now I've said that it starts changing from sandy to loamy and then clay type. Okay, now another very important part of it is that clay soil can be classified into two very important types. Number one is called new alluvium, also it is called by the name khadar, and the other one is called old alluvium, And the other name of old alluvium is Bhangad. Okay. New alluvium Khadar, old alluvium Bhangad. Clear? How we can classify these? What are the important features of all these? First of all, children, you should understand, new alluvium is always deposited close to the flow of river. Right? Always in the river basin, you'll find the soil which is deposited close to the flow of water, flow of river. You will find it is Khadar soil, or you can say it is a new alluvium soil. Right? But as compared to that, if you move away from the flow, within the basin only, if you move away from the flow, you'll find the soil which was deposited a little earlier. Right? That is actually called as old alluvium, or it can also be called as Bhangad. Right? Another thing is that in the case of Khadar, generally, because it is you know, replenished, or you can say it is renewed every time, right? So Khadar soil is always considered as more fertile than the Bhangad soil, or you can say the new alluvium is always more fertile than the old alluvium soil. Okay, this is a very important feature of it. Moreover, you can say the fine particles of the new alluvium is also a little different from the old alluvium, which are coarser in particles. Then the old alluvium has got several lime nodules also. Okay, so these are actually the different features, how we can differentiate between Khadar and Bhangad. Now come to another classification on the basis of location where the alluvial soil has been deposited, right? In which part of Indian subcontinent it has been deposited. So here it can be classified into three main categories. Number one is inland alluvium. Number two is deltaic alluvium. And number three is coastal alluvium. Okay. Now, which areas do you find the inland alluvium? On this map, you can see the northern plains of India, right? The entire northern plains, because these are inland, these are not the coastal, or you can say these are not very close to the sea or ocean. These are away from Etna. Yes, these are lying in the interior parts. And so these are called as inland. Okay, so the first type is inland alluvium, is actually found in the Ganga basin. Okay, this is inland alluvium, right? And it is rich in potash, alumina and lime, right? Naturally, it is poor in, according to its nature, it is poor in nitrogen and phosphorus. Okay, this is one. Number two, the second type of alluvium which is found according to the location where these are deposited, the second type is coastal alluvium. Coastal alluvium can be marked over, these can be found along the coastal areas, you know, children. Along the western coast as well as the eastern coastal area, right, where little deposition of sediments have been there. Here the work of sea waves or the ocean water can also be seen, right? The coastal alluvium is mainly the work of sea or the ocean water. By the waves these are deposited, so these are called as the coastal alluvium, right? Now, besides this, one more type is there, deltaic alluvium, which is found along all the deltaic regions. You can see here the Ganga Brahmaputra Delta, or you can say this as Sundarban Delta, right? Then Mahanadi Delta, where I'm showing you here. This is Mahanadi Delta. Then come to Godavari, Krishna, Kaveri, all these deltas, whatever are there along the eastern coast of India. You'll find the alluvium soil which is deposited in the deltaic regions, that is referred as deltaic alluvium. Okay, this particular type of alluvial soil is called by the name deltaic alluvium, and it is rich in, by its nature, it is rich in potash, alumina and lime, as well as This is the only type of alluvium soil which is rich in nitrogen and phosphorus also. Okay, and even the humus content.